Hello, everybody, and welcome, welcome, welcome to the show. I am Stephanie D. Sanders, and my goodness, Chef, I have got a guest for you today. I almost couldn't contain myself. I saw her the other day on LinkedIn. Yes, I did. I saw her, and when I saw her, my hands went to, I'm about to type her a message right now. Ooh, and she came back within, I'd say, within less than 60 seconds. Might have been 2 minutes, but that's okay. I was still waiting because I felt the spirit that she was going to come back and connect, and she did, and she agreed to be a guest here with me today, and I just wanted to talk to her, see what's going on in her world, let her tell us about herself. Jello! I was so excited. I was going to tell her as I introduced her. I was so excited. You know what? Let me just bring her on, and then I'll tell her how I was feeling. Ladies and gentlemen, I put your hands together at home, jump up, spin around for a woman that's been a part of a woman's group, band, all these women playing instruments back in the day, 80s. Little kids today, y'all need to learn something from this type of an artist. Longevity, just talented. I'm not going to give away right in the intro, but please, please, please take a moment to welcome to the show from the group Climax. Did you hear what I say? Climax. Cheryl Cooley, welcome to the show, Cheryl. Hey, girl. I know you ain't had no kind of introduction like that ever before, did you?
It was great. I'm sitting on pins and needles like, who is it?
Right? Right? See, that introduction is going to go down in history right there. I feel it. I feel it in my spirit. But I'm telling you, when you connected with me, Cheryl, you got back with me. I said, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait. Is this really her? Huh? If it is, I'm going to respond right now. And when I felt like it was you, oh my goodness, oh my goodness, I turned into what? I turned into a fan all over again. I turned into a just a straight up fan. I was in here by myself. I was, oh, Lord, have mercy, we about to do this. I was so excited.
Oh, thank you.
I couldn't help myself. I literally couldn't help myself because, see, folks, you may not know. Some people may not know, but quite a few of us do know this group from the 80s. Climax, come on, y'all. A group of all women, all of them, bad to the bone, playing instruments and coming out with hit after hit after hit. You have to give them props. And Cheryl said yes, and she's here. So she's going to talk to us a little bit about herself, her life, her career, and all of that. Because I wanted to know, you know, I'm supposed to be interviewing her, but I'm sitting here doing almost like a documentary. Myself.
We're going with the flow here.
I'm just going, child. I did have a little coffee before we started. So, but Cheryl, you know, I want you to jump in. And I want you to tell us a little bit about yourself before the group. Who was Cheryl back then?
Okay. You know, it's interesting. My parents, for some reason, every other Christmas, I had a toy guitar under the tree. And so my sister, who's 16 years older than I am, she was married to a jazz musician by the name of Hubert Laws. Mm-hmm. And he was on tour and at my parents' house, and he had a guitar. He's actually a flautist. Ooh. But he had his guitar, and I had my guitar. And it's like, oh, let's play guitars. And, you know, as God, the universe, whatever you believe in would have it, it had my guitar accidentally tuned to a TV show. And so, you know, it was like, hey, we should get Cheryl some guitar lessons. So I started taking guitar lessons when I was 11 years old and, you know, studied music all through school. I studied composition. You know, I did actually some writing in high school for the marching band, for the football games. Mm-hmm. You know, I just, you know, music was, since there was, you know, just the two of us and she was gone away and I was, you know, we were like the only child of the same family. Mm-hmm. The guitar was my playmate. So I went to college and studied music, commercial music, and got my degree in commercial music. And it all laid the groundwork for what was to come in my life. Because, you know, as I try to inspire people, I always say, I knew I was going to be a star. I had no doubt. I didn't have any, how do I say, I didn't have any precedence to know that I couldn't make it. That was it. That's all I knew. Right. I was gonna. That was it. That's all I saw. That's all I knew. Right. I saw bands on TV. I was like, that's what I want to do. That's what I want to do. And like I said, my sister was married to a professional musician, so I was around professional musicians to hear their talk, their speech, their garb, and all of that. So it was in my atmosphere, my vibration.
Right.
So I just knew. I just kept, you know, when I would go to school and, you know, I'd catch the bus to school and I would be looking for somebody to get on the bus and say, hey, Cheryl, we want to sign you to this contract. Just how my imagination was. I just knew it was going to happen.
So, right. How did you get with the guitar? There's so many instruments. What drew you to the guitar?
Well, like I said, you know, I always had a toy guitar every other Christmas. I mean, that was just like a standard gift I was given. So it was just right there, you know.
Okay.
The only instrument that was really around me, and I maybe my mom was psychic and she was like, okay, this is about to happen for her. Let me make sure she has one.
Right. Because I was like, now who thought to get her a guitar? Was it you? Were you feeling it? Did you touch one? You know, sometimes when you see stuff like that and you touch it or whatever, or you hear it and you're there in the presence of things like that, something just resonates with your spirit about what you're doing.
Yeah. And I had seen bands on TV, you know, with the guitars and the drums. So that's all I could see was guitar. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That was just, it just gravitated to me. I gravitated to it.
Wow.
You know what I mean? But, you know, let me say, I mean, I'm a firm believer in, metaphysics and positive thinking. So, I mean, I just think, you know, the vibration of what my being was there for the guitar to just say, okay, here we go. We're gonna take this trip in life together.
Mm-hmm. So it's really more like an attraction for certain things, but you already felt that within yourself.
Yeah.
And then got stronger as you continue, to play with it or to interact with other people, you know, and you got that ear for that instrument. And okay, now I know what this really sounds like. It's not a toy. Well, I'm going to take my toy back to the house and I'm going to play this over here. We have a good time, and then you started feeling it, and then it just got ingrained in your spirit. This is it! Wow!
You know, like I said, I saw them on I saw guitar players on TV, and I remember actually having a dream, a daymare, a nightmare. I don't know what you want to call it. And I saw myself on stage, you know, playing guitar. I mean, you know, there was the whole thing. I was on stage, the music was going, the lights were going, the band was going, I was playing, I was getting ready to step up to the microphone and sing. And all of a sudden I looked over to my right at the band. I thought, gee, they look kind of different, but oh well, let's start singing. Now, fast forward, I don't know, maybe 15, 20 years or whatever, we were performing at the Olympic Auditorium and in Los Angeles, California. And the lights were going, the music was going, you know, I was playing guitar, I was singing. All of a sudden, it was a deja vu moment. I was like, oh my God, here's the dream. So I said, well, what was it about the band I couldn't decipher in the dream? And I looked over at the band, it's like, it's an all-female band.
Wow.
Well, that's like a dream come true. I guess I stepped into a dream come true.
Wow.
Yeah.
And you think about that, the power of that, were you even looking to be in a group? Were you looking to be in a group? Were you seeking out to play for other people?
I mean, I guess that's really all that I knew because I saw it on TV. Uh-huh. But even growing up and learning how to play guitar, I mean, my school teachers would have me play for their different classes. You know, like I might have had them for science and maybe they wanted me to play for their math class. Mm-hmm. So I was, you know, used to playing guitar and singing, you know, on my own, you know, with other audiences and stuff. So it was just already there.
So now, before we jump off into the musical side of things, I want to kind of digress. And I thought I had read or heard somewhere that you don't really cook. You don't really prefer to cook. You don't really want to cook. But you know what? I can't even judge you about that. Cheryl, I can't even judge you, but you know why? You know why?
Why?
Because you and I are right here. You hear what I say? We are on the same journey. I don't cook. I cook, ma'am. I wait, not I take over. I cook, but I cook just enough not to starve. And I wanted to know if I had a confidant in this arena with me.
Yes. Hallelujah. But I gotta tell you my story, though.
Please tell the story.
What happened?
I'm just glad to know that somebody else out there besides me and Carissa. Carissa, hey, hey, I'm sorry I done shouted your name out there in Atlanta. I'm sorry. She don't cook either. Yes.
So, you know, I mean, I was a kid and my mom was like, you know, come in the kitchen. I want to teach you how to cook. You know, I really wasn't interested, but, you know, I went in the kitchen and she saw I wasn't paying attention. And, you know, just so happened the den and the kitchen were right together, right? So she said, look, if you're not going to pay attention to learn how to cook, go in the den and practice your guitar. What do you think I chose?
Right? Right?
Oh, I can say I can play guitar better than I can cook.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Okay. Yeah, just tearing it up like I'm already at the Oscars on stage, just going crazy in your mind. Because that's the way most artists do. Yeah. Well, I can't say most artists, but most artists who have that vision like you had, and I got it too. When you have that type of a vision, it's a different level to that thing. Yeah. You know, you can start seeing yourself in those different places and so forth. So for her to tell you to go out there and practice, that was just getting me closer to my goal. Mama, thank you so much. Bye-bye. I'm going out here and play. So, girl, was that part of the story? Did you try again, maybe to cook a little bit? Or, well, how you eating and living now, though? If you're not cooking.
You know, I have friends.
The shit.
And also, see, I used to live next door to my mom. You know, I live in a complex where, you know, she lived next door till she passed away. I could go over there and eat. My sister also lived in the complex. I could go over there and eat. So, you know, there's always somewhere to eat.
Wow. See, she had it good. She had it good. Mm-hmm. I did learn how to boil some hot dogs, you know, eggs, you know, little things like that. Because if it's not written on the box.
Right.
If it's not written on the box on a piece of paper.
Exactly.
45 minutes. Put it in there. Put it on this right here. I think I might have got 5 recipes from other family and friends over the years, you know. And you learn that and you master that. You master that. You can do that. But anything else you want to ask me, all this pork chops and steaks and all those things like that, you just cooking off the cuff. I'm going to hire somebody.
But can I tell you about the egg that I left on the stove boiling and it exploded and I still can't find it today?
I've done that too, Cheryl. Oh my God. And then it stinks up the house really bad.
No, not really bad. I can't find all the pieces. It happened some time ago.
You know, we have elevated though. It's a good thing we have elevated. You got you a chef. I got me 5 extra, you know, recipes and bags of food and things like that I can look at the directions.
Uber. Call Uber. Come
so we're good. We're good. You know what? We're going to have to get us some sort of a t-shirt. I don't know. Something like that. Start our own group. Something like that. It's a support group. That might be a TV show. That might be a TV show for us. Don't let me give that away. But yes, girl. So now, I see a little guitar over there. I see what you're doing. I see the little guitar over there. So, but before we get into that, we're going to take a quick break here in just a moment. And I wanted to leave the second half of this show for Cheryl to just go in. Just go in, girl, and tell us about the group. Tell us about you. Play something live. And then tell us about where you are today.
Okay.
I wanted to leave all that good stuff right then. If there's anything else you want to talk about from the past, before we get to the other side, I want you to go in. I want you to go in with everything you got, Cheryl, and tell the people about Climax. That thing almost made me cry when I saw her say yes. All I could think about was those songs in my head. Oh my gosh, we're going to talk about I Miss You. When we come back, we're going to talk about I Miss You first, okay? Please don't let me forget that. All right.
Okay.
Stay right there, guys. We'll be right back in just a moment with Cheryl Cooley from the group Climax.
I've got to get
everybody, and welcome back. Welcome back. Welcome back to this wonderful interview that we have been doing with Miss Cheryl Cooley from the group Climax. What? Huh? I just said it, Climax. I was telling her before the break.
Peak of musical excitement.
Huh?
Ultimate peak of musical excitement.
Oh.
Climax.
I was not ready for that. I wasn't ready for that. The ultimate peak. Wait a minute. You say it again. I don't want to mess it up. I don't want to get the definitions crossed.
Climax. The ultimate peak of musical.
The ultimate peak of music. Wow. Wow. That is so, so true. Oh, my God. Oh, my gosh. You really have to be involved in music or... But God gives all of us different likes and different gifts and things like that. And to be in music, to understand music to a certain degree or whatever, it's just something about music that just really just turns us on.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I'm very eclectic when it comes to music. I can listen to just about anything, you know, and find some joy in it or find something. Ooh, I really like the way that. I can bypass all the vocals and hear the music, you know, of what I like about this particular piece of music. Ooh, but I did like the way that they sung that. And I turned on, let me forget. Thank you, Lord. I wanted to swoop on back in on this right here because they came out. We get back to the interview because we didn't pop off. They came out. I think I was in high school, last couple of years in high school. They started popping out with singles and kind of jumped ahead, but that's okay. One of these songs here resonated with me so much, Cheryl, and you can talk about the song here in just a moment or even play it. Oh my gosh, I might lose it if you play it. It was I Miss You. Had an incident in high school I was dating. Messed around and broke up with my boyfriend because I thought he was cheating. Somebody told me he was potentially cheating. And so I broke up with him. He told me somebody was, I was almost destroyed. My spirit was so heavy and I was at home moping around. I played that song, Cheryl. I played that song almost about 20, 25 times on that little red box that my mama had got me. She finally asked me what was wrong. I told her I broke up with him because one of my friends said he was potentially cheating. My mom looked at me. Don't you ever break up with your man because another woman tells you to or tells you something. You go talk to them and then you guys figure out are you going to stay together or not. Now granted, she was telling the truth. The girl was telling the truth. He was cheating. So I figured that out. But that song right there was I Miss You.
Wow.
Yeah. I'm sorry, Cheryl. I just went off on a tangent. That thing there was so deep. That thing was so deep for me. That's how much you guys affected me with your music at that time. It was an awesome piece. The lyrics. Yeah. People don't recognize sometimes the lyrics.
Yep.
That go with the songs. Yeah. And the music combined together. How important is that, Cheryl, being a songwriter and a musician, to make those things match up together to create a hit song?
You know, creativity has its own path. And really, us humans are just the vessel. The music itself or the creative force of music just kind of comes through us. And, you know, it's like a marriage. The lyrics and the music, they complement each other. And, you know, there are times when, you know, one person might write the music and the other person might write the lyrics. But the vibration of the idea itself, it still marriages the lyrics for the music to kind of match each other. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, of course, as creativity sometimes has this little faux pas. Yeah, you know, there may be some times where it's like, whoops, but
Yeah. Well, we live and we learn. We live and we learn from those moments. Yeah. You continue to write. You continue to play. And I mean, you have mastered this thing to such a wonderful degree in what you do. Tell us, how did you actually get hooked up with Climax? How did you get connected with them?
Yeah. Well, first of all, let me say, we all didn't know each other before we got in that rehearsal room. And it was really like fate put us together. Everybody has their own story about how they wound up in that rehearsal room. Uh-huh. I had you know, kind of just finished college, and I was playing with a lot of different professional groups, you know, like backup bands, you know, backing up for mm-hmm. a vocalist or something. Mm-hmm. You know, and at that time, being a female instrumentalist was, you know, quite rare. Mm. And so, you know, I was used to playing with guys all the time. And I was at a rehearsal, and I saw these girls looking in the window, looking at us rehearsing. And I was like, okay, they're looking at me because I'm in this band with all these guys playing. And they just walked into the room and said, hey, you don't want to play with this band. You want to play with our band. We have an all-female band called Climax.
Wow.
And I was like, oh, okay. You know, that's a little strange.
Okay. What's really going on?
And, you know, because I had been playing with professional guys, you know, my judgment was, I don't think these girls can play. I don't think I'm going to do it. So I, you know, I didn't go to the rehearsal. I was like, it's not going to work. So then I got the guilt.
Wow. Right? Right?
I got the guilt. You know,
you never know.
Yeah. You know, you should have called. You should have went. You should call them and see when's the next one. So I called, you know, we didn't have cell phones, so I had to wait till I got home so I could call. And I said, hey, you know, I'm sorry I missed your rehearsal. When's mm-hmm. the next one? Oh, it's tomorrow. I was like,
but you weren't ready for that one. You weren't even ready for that. We just called, you know.
Yeah. So I went to the rehearsal, and the thing that really kept me there was they were having fun. You know, it's one thing to be in a band and you're, you know, you're working, you're playing music, but to go into a band and you're having fun playing music, that's really what kept me there, even though the musicianship wasn't where, you know, like I said, I mean, I had hung out with professional musicians, I had my degree, but the it was fun, you know, creative and, you know, just really a light of it. It wasn't so much heaviness of it, of, you know, get the note right. Mm-hmm. So, you know, with my musical, you know, degree and knowledge, I wrote out some songs to, you know, from the radio so we could practice. And then I realized when I handed them the charts that nobody could read music.
Oh.
Well, I was like, not to embarrass them. I said, you know what? Maybe I wrote it wrong. Let me show you what I wrote.
Right. And, you know, oh, good. That was a good saying.
Yeah. So, I mean, we practiced a song and we got them, you know, like this sounded on the radio. And, you know, a couple of the other girls came in, like the lead vocalist. She had originally auditioned for Rolls Royce, and they told her she sang too strong for them and sent her over to us. And the keyboard player we got out of a newspaper that, you know, sold refrigerators and used cars.
Wow.
So everybody really had their own story how they got there.
Mm-hmm.
So we really didn't have a chance to play the club circuit. You know, it was like we kind of, like I said, fate just kind of threw us together, and we started, you know, kind of writing some songs. And because I had hung out, you know, with professional musicians, I knew how to put a demo tape together. I knew how to put a promo package together. Mm-hmm. So we went into a 8-track studio then.
Wow. You know, we had to start somewhere.
Yeah. And, you know, we recorded about three original songs. And, I was working at a bank also at the time, and I was telling my supervisor about this all-girl band I was in, and, you know, telling about going into their studios and stuff. So she said, well, if you give me the demo tape and a picture, I'll give it to my uncle. He's a producer for Peeble Bryson. His name is Johnny Pate. I said, oh, okay, you know, because remember, I know that I'm going to be a star. I'm going to be a professional musician. Mm-hmm. So for her to say that, it's like, oh, finally, you got my script.
Mm-hmm. See how things start lining up?
Yeah.
You're working in a bank.
Exactly. So, you know, we gave him our demo tape, promo picture and everything, and he had us come over for a meeting, and he said, well, it's really not that good. How about you try it again? So, you know, oh, we're devastated, right? But let me just say, when one door closes, that does not mean another door won't open. Mm-hmm. So he just happened to be having lunch with a lady by the name of Margaret Nash, who was the vice president of Solar Records. And he said, you know, I got this all-girl band. It's a demo tape. I don't think it's all that good, but hey, maybe you could. She said, all-girl band? Where are they? You know, one door closes, another door opens.
That's right.
So, you know, she called me and said, when's your rehearsal? And she came down to our rehearsal. We started playing. She was all smiles. The next rehearsal, she brought the president of the company, Solar Records, Dick Griffey, mm-hmm. and what we finally found out was going to be our producer, Otis Stoke. And they signed us up immediately. I mean, we weren't even together a year, and we had already signed a record contract.
Wow.
Our first album came out called Never Underestimate the Power of a Woman, which was one of the songs on the demo tape that I had wrote the music for, and mm-hmm. That was our first single. Yeah.
Wow. Now, once you got the first set of music done and they started to put you guys out, how were you received as an all-female band in a probably predominantly male arena?
Right. Well, you know, video hadn't come out yet, so they mm-hmm. hadn't seen us. But, you know, the DJs, you know, would see the album covers and stuff.
Yes.
And our first album, like I said, called Never Underestimate the Power of a Woman, they would say, oh, here's a band called Climax. You know? And, you know, it didn't do that well, so we had an opportunity to do a second album. Mm-hmm. And it's like, oh, here's the band Climax. Now, mm-hmm. on that album, we had a song on there called Wild Girls, produced by these new producers called Jimmy Jam and Jimmy Terry.
Can you imagine being in a studio with Jimmy Jam and Terry?
Right. And then the third album, you know, we had changed distributors to MCA, and they loved the idea of an all-female band, mm-hmm. and they released the song The Men All Pause, and then all of a sudden the DJs were like, oh, and here's Climax. So we went from the Climax.
It's like 1, 2, 3, we're here.
Right, right.
You know?
But by then, when Men All Pause had been released, video came out. So then, you know, the buying audience could see, oh, that's what an all-female band looks like.
Mm-hmm.
So it was really video that helped the vision, the visual,
yes,
for people to go out and buy the song.
Yes.
Even as of today, my favorite video is The Men All Pause.
Wow. Ooh, what was that? What was that one line or so?
I knew I was looking good.
Was she speaking in speaking another language? Well, I just lost it. You hear me? I don't know what she's saying. I don't care what she's saying. It's like when Janet Jackson was talking in French or whatever, and one of her songs, I don't even care what she said. Oh my God, what? It just sent it over the top, you know, for me. And the way it was said, it just walk up in the video and just kind of with the little hair over the eye. I was like, oh my God, I'm about to cry right now. I just loved, see, that's just a love for music, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Sure.
Coming up dancing, you know, groups and break dancing and all of that, and DJs and radio announcing and things like that. All that music just came in, and it's like you start getting all these different artists. Music back then was just so different than it is today. I mean, it is what it is as it's evolved or whatever. But I, before we even finish, I just want to say thank you guys for really just putting it out there, putting your heart and soul out there, just giving us some interesting music and definitely something great. Look at us all, ladies. You know how empowering that was?
Yeah.
Did you get that? Did you get a lot of that?
Well, you know, we didn't realize how much of an effect it was making then. Of course, until later, you know, like, oh, because we were having fun. We were just thinking about what we experienced, you know?
Yes.
So we, you know, especially now, even, you know, people come and say, when that song played, I felt like, and the songs go on and on and on.
Wow. So let's see what I got here. I was, I told you about that when I was in high school. Yeah, I broke up. And I just went on about my business with that one there. But anyway, then, you know, I healed and everything went on, but I could have been a backup singer in your group. I played that song so many times. Huh? I was going to town. And then you had Meeting in the Ladies' Room, yep. I Miss You, The Men All Pause. I'm like,
yeah.
You all were just hitting it just one right after the other. And it was just so powerful at that time. If you don't mind, I know I might be off the cuff. I see you got your little guitar back there in the back kind of stuff. But we do know you play the guitar. So since it's there, can you play us just a little something? I don't even care what it is, but can you play, well, you know, Meet in the Later Room something? What was that line?
Have a pick. Oh, Lord. Let me see what I can do. Can you hear this?
Yes. Almost started singing. I Miss You, Chuck.
Got a meeting in the ladies' room.
Oh, be that real soon. She brought up and she walked up in the meeting room. And Stella, I was covered. I don't even know what she said. A BW, a basic woman. A basic woman. What else you got, Cheryl? What else you got? Can you play some I Miss You? Girl, I was going over.
Oh, my God. Okay,
what is this? Oh, Cheryl. Can you play that part where it's like, I've got to get
them. Oh, God. Okay. Oh, yeah.
I'm about to sing them now, girl. Hey, don't pop out now because I want to have it together. Yeah, I've been through this kind of weather. If it's over now, be strong. Can't believe that you're gone. I got to carry on my I Miss You. Girl, I almost went in concert. I'm trying to tell you.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, man. So we have sung. We have played. We've been interviewing. So now tell us, where is the group now? Because the last time I think I don't know if it was you or it was somebody, I was at working at EUR in Atlanta. Hey, Loretta. Loretta was interviewing you all. It might have been, I don't know, 03, 05, something like that.
Yeah.
What's going on with the group now? Because I saw you then, and I see that there have been some adjustments, but the group is still going on. Cheryl said, I'm about to keep this train moving. You hear what I said? I'm going to keep this train. Tell us, what's happening with the band right now?
Well, you know, the fans, the friends, the family, you know, they really support me, support the music. And so my thing is, you know, the music, the legacy, the music of Climax. People still want to hear it. They still want to, you know, experience the songs. Yes. So, you know, I'm out there performing. Yes, not all the original, but, you know, when the people get into the music, it's about the music. It's about the music. It's always about the music. Once they hear the song, they really, you know, are able to whatever, reminisce, or maybe there's some new fans, you know, get into the songs and stuff. So, you know, whenever I get a chance to perform and get on stage, I mean, I'm right there. The booking agents can check me out on climax.com.
There we go. Plug climax.com.
Right.
Climax.com.
Exactly. And, you know, I've been back out there, wow, I think like 15 years now, I guess I've been doing this again.
Oh.
Yeah, I think it's about 15 years.
Because that probably was around the time then when I yeah. had seen you or something that was yeah. probably around that time when you guys were coming yeah. back. It's yeah. awesome, 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 awesome. Yeah. You've been doing this 15 yeah. years after yeah. the right. initial group. And how long were you guys actually together with the original group?
Well, you know, and we were really, you know, fortunate that we were together for almost 10 years, I think, you know, and, that, and for a lot of bands, you know, they aren't together longer than yes. 3, maybe 5 years.
Maybe
we,
5 years.
We actually, yes. you know, we're signed to a recording contract with Solar and MCA for a good 10 years. You know, and then the 90s came in and the music changed and being a live band was no longer popular.
mm-hmm. But it is at festivals. It is at festivals and tours that go around. COVID just came, so everybody's trying to meet outside.
Oh, yeah, for sure now. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know,
so the opportunity
now,
for, you know, old school bands to get back out there
mm-hmm.
In the early 2000s, you know, the opportunity knocked on the door. You know, some of the girls wanted to do it, some of them didn't, and then, you know, it didn't look like it did in the 80s, so they got a little discouraged, but I really yes. wanted to continue, and so I continued, you know, yes. and as long as the fans show up, I'm going to keep showing up. It's a marriage.
You know? Because there are people out there that definitely want to continue to hear
yeah.
the music. Yeah. They yeah. really, really do, and
yeah.
even though COVID came and took things kind of outside of the buildings most of the time, most of the people actually do love going out to those festivals
yeah.
and things like that when they have the amphitheaters and you're outside at yeah. those events. They love those kind of things. So it's really a good thing to flip it back over for you guys to come on back out and keep doing what you're doing. You
yeah.
know, it's just yeah. you're the only one, original one in the group at this particular time, but how has that been for you, being the only original member from
You know, like I said, when we get on stage and they hear the music, I'm gonna tell you, even some people say, "You guys look just the same." Yeah, you know, I'm not gonna spoil their fantasy. Hey, you know,
thank you so much. Oh, you guys age so well. You still look young. You're what you doing? What you drinking?
Tell me this brand of that aloe vera you
drink. Right, what kind of aloe vera you drink? Look like you're 27.
But, you know, it like I said, the legacy, the music, the passion of it drives me, keeps me going.
Mm-hmm.
When the fans are out there and they're enjoying the music, that keeps me going. You know, as long as they show up, I'm going to show up. It just, you know, that's their energy is what drives me. You know, and I, you know, I love climax music. I mean, I love singing about the menopause.
Yes.
I love singing about
yes.
meeting in the ladies' room, which
yes.
is really a true story. You know,
I mean,
those songs really mean a lot of things. So, you know, I'm going to continue on as long as I can. As long as the fans show up, I'm going to show up.
Wow. Now, how often are you guys actually performing nowadays? Is it every weekend?
Well, you know, it's it kind of fluctuates. Sometimes it's once a month. Sometimes it's three times in 1 month. Maybe it might not be for another couple of months. So it kind of fluctuates, you know. And then, of course, the touring season is usually between, April to about October-ish, you know, when there's no snow.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
There's no snow.
I don't think nobody's going to be out there. They're not going to be outside with no snow.
Right, right, yeah.
And you don't want to do it either. How are you going to play and you can't feel your fingers? That's not going to work, Cheryl. I'm just saying. It's not going to work. But since that time, I've seen a couple different times where you were at award shows here. What's this other big award? I just thought you was.
Yeah,
I thought she was holding a nice big award. I was like, oh, but that's my message. Mm-hmm. And I did.
Yeah. Actually, this is the first year that they've had the Women's Songwriters Hall of Fame. Now, they have Songwriters Hall of Fame, but this one is specifically for, you know, women songwriters. And I was, you know, really honored to be, you know, participate in the first one that they've had, the first annual they're going to, you know, definitely have it again, hopefully. Mm-hmm. You know, hopefully they made enough impressions on the investors to keep it going.
Yes.
But I was really quite honored that they, you know, wanted to honor Climax. And, you know, I got out my little money out of my own little pocket and paid for my ticket and paid for my hotel and went to Washington, D.C. and, you know, accepted the award for the band because it was really important for us to show up.
Yes. Well, we talked about the band a little bit, and I just want to ask, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. You know, I mean, here in California, of course, we had the stay-at-home order and all of that. But, you know, I was okay with it. You know, it all worked out for me. Mm-hmm. Got a chance to do some home remodeling.
Wow. She went to home remodeling. You know, there are people I heard that were doing that. They were doing the home remodeling. You at the house. You know, you at the house. You might as well be useful.
Yeah, and you know, when we had when there was the pause in the Climax music during the 90s, I became an electrician. So that's how I learned, you know, some building and remodeling skills. I know you probably can't see it, but I'm in my rehearsal room that I built, you know.
Yes,
for the
I
band.
See it.
It's in disarray right now, but we have a bar, we have a disco light.
Look here, you need to go to HGTV.
Right?
HGTV, right. You're a celebrity, you're an electrician, right. Go to HGTV and get you a show.
Okay.
And then play one of the songs during the show.
Yeah, right, exactly.
I tell you what, see, I'm about to give some ideas. Go get you a show, do that. Go when you go to town and you do some things. I don't know how you want to do that. I don't know if you want to do homes, businesses, or whatever. Find you a spot somewhere where you actually do one song that you want to perform in that city. You know, one of your songs you perform in that city, it can go on, you know. They'll figure out something for you because that's a totally different kind of a field or whatever. Left field. I don't know why I'm talking because I did the same thing. I went left field from communications over to surgical tech and then to education. So, but I'm coming back. I'm coming back, entertainment.
Oh,
I see you. Like you said, keeping the vision strong, though. Yeah. Now, tell us, let's see, what is your goal for maybe the next 3 to 5 years so far as the band Climax?
You know, like I said, keep performing. You know, we've done a couple of new songs on our website and, you know, record some more, perform some more. For me, music is 24/7. You know, when somebody says, well, what hobbies do you have? And it's like, music?
Electrician.
Right.
And my studio at home.
Right, yeah.
Yes.
I mean, that's my heart, my passion. So I'm glad that I have an opportunity to do it and, you know, put some smiles on people's faces. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm going to keep doing it until that the piano player, UB Blake, who died at his piano at 100 years old.
Wow. She's going to be in there in that room right there.
Yeah.
With her cute little guitar and just propped up. Wow. Now, one last thing. I know you had mentioned something about wearing a hearing aid. Was that because of you being in the band?
You ain't supposed to talk about it.
15, 20, 25, 26 years or so?
Yeah, it's been a while. Yeah.
That's probably what it was fun, Cheryl.
Well, you know, you got to do what you got to do. You know, I mean, you know, when I saw Quincy Jones wore them, then it was like, you know what? It's okay. You just put it on, keep going.
See, that's motivation for the people.
Yeah.
That's motivation for the people. Cheryl is keeping it moving. Even with her little hearing aid.
Yeah.
That nobody can see. Yeah. Because of her beautiful hair. But that's inspiration.
Okay.
Don't let anything like that stop you. You got another ear.
Yeah.
You can do this.
Yeah.
Wonderful. It has been such a pleasure talking to you. Didn't know, do you have anything else that you wanted to share with the people, about yourself, about the group, what's going on, the weather?
Well, you know, I want to thank you and thank your audience. Thank all the people that buy tickets to come to see our show and download our music. I mean, to me, that's really what it's all about. That is the most important factor in all of this music stuff. You know, all of the music out there, it's really about the fans that keep it going. And I appreciate it because, you know, it's a lifestyle for me. And if it wasn't for the fans, I wouldn't be able to do it. You know, please feel free to come to our website, climax.com, KLYMAX.com. You know, check out our you know, pictures and the music and the videos. Please sign up for our mailing list. You know, we can keep everybody informed as to where we're going to be performing. You know, anybody that wants to send me an email on the website, I answer my emails. I answer my emails.
That's good. That's good. Yeah,
or catch me on Facebook. I think I live there.
Wow. Well, there you have it. That's another way you can contact her. If she's not on LinkedIn, she's on Facebook.
Right, right. I check them all. LinkedIn, Instagram, you know, I check them all, you know, because sometimes people, they're not sure where to reach you.
Yes.
And, you know, if I could check all those and reach out to somebody, I don't have a problem doing that, you know, because that keeps everything going. That keeps, you know, the giver and the receiver, mm-hmm. you know, constantly in flux with each other. So I appreciate all those communications.
All right. Well, there you have it, everybody. We have spent some time. I know we probably went over time, but I don't care because it's my interview. I don't care if it's an hour. All I knew is I needed to get her on here and interview her. I just wanted to see who she was, what the group was about. They've just been such a poignant entity in my life growing up and the music industry, too. Snap, thank you so much, Cheryl, for saying yes and coming on. Thank you guys for watching. Make sure you contact them at climax.com. Contact them. And have them come out to your events. Now, don't be having to come to no backyard barbecue. We're not doing that. Contact them and enjoy more Climax coming down the pipeline. Thank you so much, guys, for watching. If you want to send me a message, you can at walkinthoughtproductions@gmail.com. And I'm your host, Stephanie D. Sanders. Thank you guys for watching. Bye.